Hi. So, first, thank you that I'm allowed to speak here, and thank you for the people behind Django Conference Europe. Thank you for organizing this great event. My name is Thomas Güttler. I'm from Germany, working for Djangsters, a software agency with a lot of experience with Python and Django. Today, I want to talk about HTMX, make web development simple and fun again. So this is not an academic, too detailed or dry talk. I wanted to be personal, opinionated, and a little bit of fun. So I studied computer science roughly 20 years ago, and finding the right front-end framework today is really hard. In the past, things were much easier since you had less options to choose from. 1999, I wrote some small TGI scripts with Shell and Perl on Linux, and it was simple and fun. Not fun were the languages. So Perl was ugly, Shell was not reliable, you don't have exceptions, and Java and C++ too complicated. So 2001, I found Python, and it was fun and easy to read. 2008, I started to use Django, and I don't regret this since 13 years. I have seen a lot of hypes coming and going, to name some: Perl, Visual Basic, Corba, XML, XSLT, Java applets, and Macromedia Flash. And I'm deeply relaxed and guess that some things we love today will be called deprecated or technical debt soon. So 2014, so roughly, I came across Angular, and it was amazing for me. It was mind-blowing. I thought, hey, that's the future. So the server sends JSON to the browser. So like a real application. But customers kept us busy doing the things we did before, so we keep on creating HTML on the server with Django and with a little bit of jQuery for the interactivity. But this equation, JSON is equal and HTML is dirty, somehow was burned into my brain. But let's talk about this later. So 6 years went by in a flash, and last year I checked, oh, what's the state of Angular today? So this is a Stack Overflow tech trend, and you see here very clearly that the Angular hype is over. So if you start a new project from scratch today, it is very unlikely that you will use Angular. So today they are React and Vue very hyped, and I played around with React, and somehow I liked it because it was a mixture, or there is a mixture of HTML and the programming language. It somehow reminds me of PHP, but executed in the browser. Then I looked at Vue, it's nice too, but for both frameworks, there was not so much of wow because I'm somehow a little bit lazy. And first I need to create an endpoint, maybe with a Django REST framework. And then on top, I can create the front end. I'm not so much amazed. So in 2021, a friend told me how she manages her work. She has a vegan lunch service organized in Excel. It was a mess. Up to now, people ordered via email and WhatsApp, and the Excel sheet was edited by her for every order by hand. So I wanted to help her, and since it was a spare time project and not for money, one thing was very important for me. It should be somehow some kind of fun. I need to love the technology stack, and that's very different from a business context. I knew I will be coding in the evening after the kids went to bed, and this means for me only roughly 30% of my mental energy will be available, so it was very important for me to reduce cognitive load. So I created a list. For the back end, it was easy. I want to use Django, but the front end list was very long. There were so many choices, and there was no favorite. Analysis paralysis. I could not act because there were too many options. I created a spreadsheet to get an overview. And one thing important is very important here. I don't get paid by the hour in this context. So I want to get the things done fast, and I want powerful tools. So that's maybe different from a business context. And I want to master the front end and the back end somehow in an easy way. And one thing in this context is there's nobody telling me, hey, Thomas, please use tool A for task B. So this freedom has a benefit I can choose, but of course it means analysis paralysis. Which tool do I want to use? So I had the front-end blues. I still haven't found what I'm looking for. So what I did, I tried to relax and said, really calm and get rid of the pressure, relax. What do you enjoy? What do you like, Thomas? And there are some things which I like. For example, I like the Django forms library. It's an easy way to create HTML forms on the server, and that's really cool way. And you can then validate the user input which you get from the client, and that's very handy, and that's a thing which I really, really like. So another thing which I like is Django ORM. So it's a very cool interface to a SQL database. So it's very clean and powerful. And there are some other things, of course, which I like as a web developer. HTTP is cool, HTML, CSS, and what I want as a user, I want a fast page load. I want to get to the URL and then bam, I want this page to be visible as a user. And as a developer, JavaScript, that's somehow not my favorite. So I ask myself, Thomas, what do you want to improve? So one thing, of course, I want to avoid the full page reload after submitting a form. So this very old post redirect get pattern, oh no, I don't want this. And maintaining and do-it-yourself JavaScript library for submitting and reloading snippets, I don't think that this would be fun. So let's have a look at this use case from a bird's eye perspective. I have one page and there are several paths on this page. And I want to update each part on its own. So the part one could be, for example, a new sticker, part two could be a complex form, and part three could be a chat or something like this. And if you paint this picture to a developer, most people have the answer immediately. They know it right now. Say, hey, Thomas, you need a single page application. All right, thinking fast, thinking slow. Let's wait. I have several pages, and each page should be some kind of interactive or updatable. So I don't have one page. No, I have several pages, and each page should be, some kind of interactive. That's what I want. And if you reject this modern front-end frameworks and you talk to people and they start to argue, hey, wait, Thomas, form validation in the browser is a really cool thing and you need to use JavaScript for it. And of course, it makes sense to have form validation in the browser sometimes, but overall, one thing is clear. I need to validate the data on the server side if I receive it again for security reason and just to be safe that I only store valid data into this database. And overall, HTML5 has some cool features too. And yes, maybe I need form validation in JavaScript later, but not at the moment. At the moment, simple form handling is enough for me. And reusing JavaScript on the backend just to reuse some three lines of code, well, I know this makes no sense for me. Then if you look around the current trend, server-side rendering, it's a big hype. And I looked at the implementations of Next.js and Nuxt.js, but somehow I feel like this cartoon figure, which you see here. So you have a huge stack and it's getting bigger and bigger, and it's not a foundation. It's a huge tower, and it does not feel, at least for me, does not feel so stable, not like a foundation which I can build upon. And so I want good web vitals and other modern alternatives to server-side rendering. Yes, and then I found a cool page from the Google blog. It's called Rendering on the Web, and it compares several ways to render HTML today on the web. On the left-hand side, the left column, that's the traditional approach. So you have maybe Django templates or maybe PHP, which renders HTML and which gets sent to the browser. And there are several ways to make this more complicated, to up to full client-side rendering. And wait, I think this traditional approach has a lot of benefits. It makes things quite easy. So I was beginning to question myself, hey, Thomas, are you stupid? Are you too old? Or are you just strange that everything is doing it completely different? I don't know. Is it just me? Ba-bam! And there came the revolution. By chance, I came across Unpoly. A big thank you to Henning Koch, the author of this library. He created a really cool comparison where he compares the page speed of Angular with his approach. And it's very clear his approach is very fast. So his approach was sending HTML fragments over the wire. First, I was unsure. Isn't this considered dirty? What will people say if I go this way? And fragments over the wire is for me a real revolution in the truest sense of the word, because it means to evolve to something which has been the state in the past. It took me some time to get this useless equation out of my head. So JSON is clean, HTML dirty, that's nonsense. If something is clean, then it's for me SQL and Python. These things are clean, and of course I need to render HTML somehow. So yes, but maybe I don't need JSON at all. So now that I have found the way I want to develop with fragments over the wire, I had analysis paralysis again. So which fragment over the wire framework should I choose? There are several, for example, Unpoly, Hotwire, or HTMX, and I was meandering forward and backward. And the cool thing about spare time projects is that there is no pressure. You have freedom. You can do relaxed decisions. In business context, this is quite different. So you have deadlines, and you would need to convince coworkers, employer, or clients to try out something completely new, and that's quite hard these days. And so I was lucky I can decide on my own and start from scratch, and I decided to use HTMX. So again, let's have a look at this picture. I have one page and several parts are on this page, and I want to update one part of this page. So here at the top, you have some HTML. At the bottom, you have some HTML. And here you have a button. And if this button gets pressed, I want to exchange this HTML with some new HTML, which I get from the server. That's how fragments over the wire works. And HTMX is quite simple. It just adds some attributes to the HTML. So for example, hxget, there's an URL, and hxswap, which defines then the swap method. I get a response from the server, from this URL, and then HTMX merges this fragment into the page using the defined method. For example, outer HTML, it could be inner HTML too. So I like to onboard everybody, so let's have a look at it step by step. Once again, so user clicks on the button. So HTMX receives the click event. HTMX does an HTTP get or post to the URL. And then the server sends a fragment, or also called snippet, to the browser. So it's just a fragment. There's no head HTML tag. There's no body tag. It's just a snippet. Could be a div or a table row or something like this. And then HTMX merges this fragment into the page. Yes, and that's it, that's all. And there's no big magic. The magic is the simplicity. Yo. While creating this slide, I realized, HTMX, it's quite similar to, and it's declarative to some other things which I like. I like HTML, so that's very similar. HTMX just adds some new attributes, and it's similar to CSS or SQL. It's similar to the Django admin, where you, in a lot of cases, don't need to write code. You just define the things you want to. And it's declarative, like a Terraform or like a Kubernetes manifest. And of course, declarative is not this golden bullet. Somehow you need to write loops on conditions. But I like to use Python for these things. Okay. So HTMLX is a JavaScript library so that you can avoid JavaScript. It works with every language on the server side and it's very small. And the cool thing about it is if you follow this pattern, the first page which the user loads is a full page and this page is already complete. So you even don't need HTMX to render the first page. And this makes this page load very fast. Here I have got some examples, but I have concerns that I run out of time. So I will look at this example at the end. So let's have a look at some philosophy here. So we have separation of concerns. I guess most people know separations of concern. It's like a rule, even something maybe like holy. You need to separate the concerns. And I have separated the concerns several times and in the past. And for example, I separate the concerns by having several files. I have a Python file and then I have an HTML or template file and then I have some CSS and some JS. So I can separate these concerns, but there's a different way you can mix these concerns to have more power, and some call this locality of behavior. So I have backend code, and in this backend code, I use format HTML and have there and create an HTML string inside my Python code. And inside this string, I use atomic or inline CSS. So I have all the things which I need in one place. And this gives me a lot of power and makes me feel productive. So up to now, I have just talking about some boring HTML extension. We are here at a Django conference. So what does this mean for me or you as a Django developer? So my way of developing Django application has changed. I now write small methods returning small fragments. And this means I switched back to function-based views instead of class-based views because this somehow feels more easy and simple. And of course, save string is super cool. I use format HTML, which uses conditional escape in the background. So I am on the safe side that no HTML injection can happen here. So that's a very cool thing with these powerful tools. And I hardly use a Django template in this context anymore. So I discovered some naming patterns which make sense to me, and maybe you like them. I want to share them with you. I have two function-based views and I have two contexts. Either I want to create a full page and then I have a method and I use a suffix underscore page. And this method returns a HTTP response, and this HTTP response contains a whole page. So you have an HTML tag, a head tag, a body tag, and so on. And I call this URL user usually foo, so without underscore page here. And if I have a function-based view, which should return only a fragment, I name this method underscore hx. So I have this naming pattern to understand the code easier, which makes it more fun for me. And this only returns a fragment. So this could be a div, a table row, or something like this. And here I leak the name into the URL namespace. So this URL is called foo underscore hx. And I think that's perfectly fine because the average user only sees this URL. That's the first page which gets loaded. And if the user wants to share or bookmark this page, that's the URL he sees. And of course, he could see these other Ajax calls in the background, but only experienced developers open DevTools and then have a look. So I think it's perfectly fine to leak this Ajax into the URL namespace. It makes it easier for me to understand what's going on if I have an exception or something like this. Of course, now we have these two function-based views. And sometimes I want to reuse an HTML snippet. So I want to use an HTML snippet in several places, and then I create a method which just creates HTML. And to make things more obvious, I use the naming pattern here, _HTML. And this can then be used in a fragment response or in a page response. But this is just my personal pattern. You can develop HTMX the way you want. So to sum it up, HTMX is great for a super fast, largest contentful paint. So to get a first time user experience and a fast page load. Compare this, for example, to loading Gmail. Gmail loading for me for the first time, if I load Gmail, it's I have this loading indicator and no, I don't want this. I want my page to be fast and immediately available. So I think HTMX is great for professional, serious, maybe a bit boring stateless applications like shops, ERP systems or database frontends. And I think HTMX is very well suited for an MVP. So you create a prototype and then you optimize later to have maybe less server round trips or maybe add later then a little bit of client side form validation to increase the user experience, but that's only some sugar. And of course there you use an JavaScript. So HTMX is not so well suited for offline first applications because the server plays a central role here. So without a server, this application won't run. I have no clue how to create offline first application with HTMX. If you have a cool idea, please tell me. And there are a lot of interactive chart libraries out there, and they usually want some JSON data. And of course, this makes sense to reuse these chart libraries. And there, HTMX makes no sense. Or what you see is what you get editor. That's an area of JavaScript on the client side, of course. So first, let's rethink what how I changed my mind. And so 6 or 7 years ago, I came across Angular and thought, "Wow, Angular, that's the future. That's so cool." And I created this picture here. So I have a server, and the server contains the nice, tasty data as SQL. And there I have some JSON API, so I can use it for a machine to machine communications, this API. And I could then build upon this JSON API some cool interface with a heavy front end framework like Angular, React, Vue, or AlpineJS. I could do this, but somehow I switched my mind because I think there are two very different use cases. And again, I have SQL on my server and I want to create a nice user interface. So, and there, of course, I will use HTML. And if I want to get from SQL to a nice user interface, I just need HTML. And on this road, at least I don't need JSON. And here's my use case. I want to improve daily. I want to have continuous integration, continuous development. So push out new features soon and in small steps. And maybe I want to do some A/B testing. No, now look at this. The other use case is in stable API. You don't do A/B testing on an API for a machine-to-machine communication. Of course, here JSON makes sense, and there the Django REST framework is great, so you can give other systems access to your database models. So I think there are two use cases, and these two use cases should use different way to get the data to the consumer then. So is this the end of the odyssey? Maybe it's just the beginning. At least I solved my front end blues and found HTMX, and now I can focus and my mental energy to get me to get me to my goal, and I have easy and lightweight tool. So I was quite fast, but we have the examples. First, I want to say thank you to my employer, the Jenksters. We are a cool company working on Python and Django. And of course, we have React developers and JavaScript experts. So if you want to get things done, please contact us. Yeah. And
managing
now,
multiple Django services in a single repo.
Okay, Thomas, thank you so much.
No, I have some minutes, I think, because I have the examples. So if I have enough time, I was unsure how fast I am. So I would like to get to the examples now.
Okay.
And please interrupt me. Please interrupt me if time is over. Yeah? Okay.
Okay. No problem.
So can you see my screen now here? I want to see HTMX. Click to edit. Could you please confirm that the users can see this?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you. So I enlarge the font a little bit. Here's a small demo. So let's have a look at how it works. This is plain HTML here, and I have a button, click to edit. If I press this button, boom, then HTMX contacts the server and fetches an HTML fragment from the server and puts this fragment into this place here, for example, a form. Then I can update my form here, and I could submit it, and again, in the background, HTMX takes my data, sends it to the server. The server replies with some plain HTML, and HTMX inserts the HTML into this part here. So, and the nice thing about the examples here, I'm at the official HTMX homepage, and I'm here at the examples, and these examples all have a nice feature. At the bottom, you can see what you have done. So it's only a fake server here in the background, and you can see what has happened here. So the initial state was that I have this div, and this div has some special attributes. For example, hx target means please update this div, and you have a swap method. Then you have this button with an hx get and so on. And here you see it's like HTML with a little bit of HTMX sugar. And if I click on the button, then I get my form from the server. This again has some tiny HTMX attributes. For example, this form should be then sent via HTTP put to the server, and then an HX web should happen. Okay, so I filled out this form, I pressed the submit button, and the third event is this, that the form gets sent to the server, and the server replies again with a read-only div of the data, which is in the database. And yes, that's easy, that's simple. That's the way I like it. And somehow I think, why hasn't this been evented somehow earlier? Maybe this even should be an official World Wide Web standard. But let's have a look at some other examples. So we have a special event here. It's a trigger event revealed, and that's something very cool. The HTMX triggers the revealed event as soon as the HTML gets into the viewable part of the page. So let's have a look. I scroll to the bottom and I see the loading indicator, and then HTMX fetches the new data from the server and inserts it into this page. And if I scroll down again, I again hit the place where this revealed event gets triggered, and I get new data from the server. And it's so simple. I can create such a lazy loading here without writing a single line of JavaScript myself. And this really fascinated me. So let's have a look at another example. animations. HTMX does a fancy trick so that you can very easily define CSS transitions. So during this swapping phase, HTMX adds CSS classes to the elements so that you can use these classes to create CSS transitions. Just have a look at this fade out demo. There's a button, and if I click on it, it will fade out. Boom, so it's gone. And this is very easy from a developer perspective. You just need to find this HTMX swapping attribute, put on this class some CSS style, and you can say opacity 0. So at the end, 0, it should be invisible. And then you can define the transition to make it fade away, this button. The same thing works for fading in. So it's here roughly the same. If you click on this button, and the fading in will be done via the HTMX settling CSS class. Yes, and for me, it's a very simple way to do front-end development, especially since I like to keep it simple and easy. So then I reached the end of my talk. I could talk for hours, but of course I want to be here to answer your questions. So that's it. Thank you for listening, and let's meet in the Jitsi room here at the bottom. So now I hope you can see me and hear me. Oh, technology. So great. So I'm here at Jitsi, and I see a lot of letters and some faces here. So yes, please speak up. I'm here to answer your question.
Yeah, thanks for your talk. I really liked it because it's something I've been looking. I've been in this dichotomy of I have some projects where I need like a very kind of interactive front end where I need to do stuff in the browser, and then I'm using Vue. But I have other places where I need just a more regular, simple app. And I didn't know how to go about it, because one of the things I'd really like about the front-end frameworks Vue and stuff is that you can very easily componentize your front-end bits in small chunks. And that was something that I found it hard to do in Django somehow, even with creating your own custom template tags and all of that. I just didn't, but this is amazing. I really like this. I want to try this now. How long have you been using this, and how long did it take you to choose between the different solutions? And
it took me some time. It took me some time to settle on HTMX, because there are several frameworks which go this way, and I'm using it. So today we have June, so since 5 months I use it now. So I'm still fresh, but nevertheless, I want to talk about it because it's so much fun and it's very easy. So, you said template tags. I don't use template tags here. I use just plain Python and format HTML and stack it together the way I like. And it works for me very well. I don't say it's a golden bullet for every use case. You said, for example, if you have a lot of interaction and client-side state, then it makes no sense. So if you have a database front end, which is a little bit of boring and maybe a lot of complex forms, in this case, HTMX makes sense. Yeah. Okay, did this answer your question somehow?
Yes. How large is, you have built one largish application with it, or?
One application I built with it, yeah.
Cool, thanks. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So don't be shy, speak up. Daniel, you want to speak? I can't hear you, Daniel.
Okay, yeah, I'm here. I was wondering whether you'd managed to sell it to your employer to use in their business.
That's a really good question. No, up to now, not. Because we have at work, we have an application which is several years old, and there is no time to rewrite something from scratch. So at my employee, I'm a senior software backend developer. I keep on doing backend stuff. But I think as soon as our agency has this matching topic, we could use HTMX for it. So up to now, as I said, it was just a spare time project, but which worked out very easily and very fine. And maybe we will use it in the business context in the future. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And one other question was, do you think it would work for a CMS type application where you have to swap from from one page to another with with the same template but different content that might be spread across the whole page?
I think for a CMS application it would fit. Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Cool. Please speak up. Any questions or comments you have? I'm here to answer your question.
There are some people speaking in the chat.
Oh, I don't see the chat. Sorry. I have not looked at it yet. Thank you. Can you give my GitHub link? No, my project I developed in spare time is not open source, at least not up to now. But the overall pattern is so easy. Just do it. I think you don't need so many. Just use it. If you know Django, if you know HTML, I think you get the concept quite soon. So at least I don't have examples here at the moment. Yeah, I have one small, but it's not a big application. Adam, you ask Abra. At least there's Django HTMX. Yes, Adam has a Django HTMX integration. So next question here is, hi Thomas, really cool library. How can I implement cascaded drop-down selects with HTMX? Just go to the examples. There is an example on the HTMX homepage and which exactly implements this cascading drop-down. They have cars. So first you choose BMW or Audi, and then you choose the type of car you want to have. Just look at the examples on the homepage. So next question, will there any page reload while HTMX merge fragments? No. So HTMX does not reload the whole page except told to do so. So next question, is there any feature routing one URL to another? No, also at least I think you don't need this URL routing. You have your urls.py in Django, and there you define your URLs and then you call your URL. So at least I think you don't need this kind of URL routing here. With HTMX, so it's plain Django.
Okay, I think that was about changing the URL history.
The URL history, of course, yes, you can. You can update the URL history. So if you want to, you can create a single page application. You can update the URL of the browser, so that you have an history and you can different bookmarks and so on. And of course, this works. Yeah.
Okay.
So thank you for the update. I did not understand the question. So, hi Thomas, if the returned HTML contains HTMX tags, does it automatically recognize them and patch them? Yes, of course, yes. So these fragments which you get from the server and which get merged into the DOM, they can contain HTMX again. So it's a little bit of recursive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, works.
Mm-hmm. Okay, one other question I thought of. Obviously, Hotwire. And you mentioned another solution, and I think Alpine.js as well.
I think Alpine.js is different.
Okay, all right. But did you specifically decide against the other two offerings, or?
Yes. I think
for any reason,
Unpoly and Hotwire are cool solutions too. Somehow it was for me that HTMX is somehow simpler. I go to the homepage, htmx.org. I see the examples, I see the docs, and I understand it immediately. For example, in Hotwire, there's a lot of like marketing, blah, blah, and I somehow don't get the real magic behind it. Maybe I'm too stupid. So HTMX was easy to understand for me. And Unpoly is somehow, it's older. And it's a little bit settled. So HTMX is a more new, there's development. And so I settled on HTMX. Yeah.
Okay.
So some more questions here. I'm curious, are forms the only mechanism available to submit data to the server? And if so, does that ever present a problem? Well, not really. So I follow the usual pattern. If I want to submit data to the server, I use a form. But HTMX allows you to make a div, a form too. So you could use HTMX to avoid forms. But overall, for me, forms don't cost money. I create the form tag and then I have the things together. You can submit data via HTMX without forms too. Yes, that's possible. So next question from Michael, is it possible an HTMX component to trigger another one? At least for me, I would answer this like this. So you have some kind of button, and if the user presses this button, you don't want this button to be replaced, but you want to update something else, maybe an icon at the top or something like this.
Exactly. Maybe the notification icon, for example, based on a server action.
Genau, okay. And then you can specify the target. There's an attribute called hxtarget, and there you can define which element in the DOM should get updated. So you don't, this was just an example with the button. It's very likely that you press a button and want to update something else. So you can specify a target here, yes. And to add something here, you have out of band data too. This means the server can send a fragment to the client, and there you can add out of band data so you can update something else. That's something very cool. For example, you have an order page and you update one order row, then the count on this row increases, and maybe you have a shopping cart icon at the top with a number of items in this cart, and you can update this too with out of band data. Okay. Adam Chains has some link here to examples. If you want to go there, have a look. I think we still have some seconds, so speak up if you have a question.
So I think you missed Israel's question, maybe.
Israel, okay. How it degrades in case of a JS3 environment? Okay. If you don't have JavaScript at all, then all these special tags get ignored. And if you want to optimize for the use case, so if you have this use case, then you could do maybe always do a full page reload every time a fragment update would happen. That's a strange use case, at least for me, because all my clients have JavaScript. But I think you can use HTMX to get something to make both happy, JavaScript free and with JavaScript, yeah.
Tying a bit into that question, do you know if there's a way to do server-side rendering with this to support those scenarios and also just initial page loads and some other scenarios where that might be needed?
Yes, server-side rendering you do with a Django function-based view, which returns HTML. Okay, next talk starts. See you, folks. Thank you for listening.